Thank you very much for the warm welcome and the invitation to speak here today. My name's Andrew Underwood. I'm the Business Development and Project Manager at VPAC, and I've been invited here to talk about high-performance computing and research and how you could potentially take advantage of high-performance computing, what is high-performance computing, and how it can benefit your research, but not only your research, the Victorian economy and the Australian economy. So with that, let's get started. So I've been working at VPAC for nearly 5 years now, and in that time, I've been very fortunate to project manage a number of high-performance computing and software development projects which focus on research and development, both academic and commercial. While doing this, I've gained great exposure to various research groups across Australia, and I've seen firsthand how they apply high-performance computing to their research problems. So today, as part of my presentation, I'm going to demonstrate how high-performance computers are applied to many different sectors and how this could help to accelerate your research. Firstly, let's take a quick look at VPAC. VPAC was founded in 2000 by a consortium of Victorian universities and the Victorian government to become a state-based supercomputing centre. Since then, we've evolved to meet the needs of our member universities and the state's industrial sector to become a recognised research provider, delivering consulting, training and expert services in the application of advanced and high-performance computing for research, technical, scientific and informatics. We now operate across the Asia-Pacific region, have partnerships with vendors Dell, Adaptive Computing, WAM Cloud and DDN, and we employ roughly 60 staff in specialized fields of geographic information systems, virtual engineering, and the market segments which I'm responsible for, advanced computing, life science, and health initiatives. We operate and maintain two data centers in the VPAC headquarters, which house roughly 3,500 cores and associated storage, as well as secure data hosting services for clients across multiple market segments. Our projects are governed under PRINCE2 guidelines, and our processes are ISO 9001 compliant. We maintain a high level of industry engagement and focus on solutions for Victorian SMEs, universities, and international organisations. If you're unfamiliar with this group of talks, we probably need to start by answering the basic question of what is high-performance computing? To sum it up, a high-performance computer is the Formula One car of the IT world. It's fast. It consists of a cluster of compute servers with a very large CPU or core count, used in close proximity to one another to solve calculation-intensive tasks and problems. Historically, in the 1970s, this was weather forecasts and aerodynamics, planes, spacecraft, cars. Then nuclear weapon simulations and radiation shielding modeling at the height of the Cold War in the 1980s. And in recent years, the emphasis has been on cracking decryption and molecular dynamics modeling. The immediate benefit of using a HPC is that it enables researchers to tackle large, real-world problems that would be far too time-consuming on a desktop PC or a local server. They assist researchers in visualizing interactions down to the molecular level, which a human eye can't see. So it might be a protein that it's trying to visualize and simulate, and using a high-performance computer, we're able to do that. The best method for taking advantage of a HPC is through parallel computing. Parallel computing is the submission of processes, that's your simulation or calculation, over one or more CPUs and by splitting up the tasks between them. As an analogy, let's consider your shopping basket a computer and the items you wish to purchase as the process. If you want to purchase more items, you have two options. One, rearrange your shopping basket for optimal efficiency. This is the same way a software engineer would optimize their code. It's very helpful, but it's limited. Your second option is to carry a second basket and have a partner distribute your items across them. This method is analogous to parallel processing in a HPC and is the most cost-effective and scalable method. Now, if you're still unsure of what a HPC is, don't worry, because the best way to understand it is to think about what's inside them. Picture the compute server on a HPC as your desktop PC or a tablet device. It contains a CPU which acts as the brains and where most calculations take place. It has RAM for the CPU to store data when it's calculating, a hard disk to store your final output, network to connect it to other devices or the internet, and it runs an operating system which coordinates it all. To run a calculation on a HPC, we submit what we call a job to a management node. This will queue and schedule your job to run. It will then submit your job onto the compute nodes you've requested and begin to take advantage of the CPU, RAM, and the disk. Once complete, you can log back into the system and retrieve your calculations for analysis. So it's as easy as 1, 2, 3, submit, run, analyze. Now, imagine you're trying to simulate the impact of an asteroid hitting the Earth. That simulation has a lot of factors to calculate. Size, speed, trajectory, impact site, etc. So it's safe to say that running that once, let alone a few dozen times for accuracy, could take a month or two on your PC. In this time, you'll most likely won't be able to use your device for email, general use, because it's going to be overloaded by resource-intensive tasks. So, what if we could slice your simulation to run across all the desktop PCs and tablet devices at this university? Rather than having one PC do all the work, we now have a small army of computers, dividing the code between themselves and running their part of the simulation. Not only will this be more effective and allow us to finish the simulation earlier, but it will allow us to scale up the amount of detail in the simulation, such as Kepler's law of planetary motion or temperature effects and tsunamis. This is parallel computing in action, and as you can see, it has immense benefits over serial computing or just using your desktop. HPC is used across not only academia, but industry and government R&D departments. When a lot of you finish your PhDs, you'll move on to industry or government, whether it's Defence or Department of Primary Industry in Victoria, who will take advantage of HPC on a daily basis. In chemistry and physics, a key ingredient to discovering the underlying structure of matter and attempting to find out what we're made of is HPC. Particle physicists use HPC to analyze the very large amounts of data being generated by the Large Hadron Collider at CERN. The automotive and aerospatial industry design aircraft wings, cabins, engines, and tires on HPC, all in order to make them quieter, more fuel economic, more comfortable, and cost-effective transportation. They assist air crash investigators to determine the cause of accidents and make sure that they don't happen again. This next video is a demonstration of how engineers can actually take advantage of high-performance computing and the software that runs on it. It's a quick snippet of a computational fluid dynamics simulation of Vespa aerodynamics for the Australian 250cc Salt Lake record attempt. It's made in open foam, and the red graphic around the rider indicates the negative pressure zones on the Vespa when traveling at 160 kilometers an hour. This actually shows engineers where they must focus to improve the aerodynamics of the vehicle before the event. With weather forecasting, it's the sheer amount of data that needs to be processed that requires the HPC. There are hundreds of thousands of weather stations around the world, each one recording dozens of variables: winds, speed, direction, temperature, humidity, pollen count. And all of this data needs to be compared to last night's data and last week's data and historical data if it exists. And all of this must be fetched from huge memory and storage banks. Generally, most of these calculations can occur at the same time. And so massive parallelism means that weather forecasts can be produced in seconds or minutes rather than hours. And this helps weather forecasters to notify smaller communities, rural communities, or even large cities when tsunamis might be approaching after underwater earthquakes, or when a hurricane or a cyclone may be occurring off the coast. In the life sciences, HPC is used to model new pharmaceutical drugs, viruses, bacteria in both medical and health science, as well as agriculture. And in this video, HPC was used to investigate the effects of resistance mutations within a crucial enzyme of HIV towards a range of antiviral drugs. It's hoped that this method will prove useful in assessing treatment options for patients presenting new drug-resistant profiles in the future. But it's a first-hand look at how HPC can visualize interactions at a molecular level. Government and military around the world use HPC to undertake their nuclear weapons simulations. Scientists model every step that a nuclear bomb takes, from storage in a silo to explosion. We're talking about a level of simulation that models whether the heat and vibration from a transport truck can affect a nuclear missile's control system, but also the simulation of what actually happens when the nuke explodes. So it tells us, well, is it better to explode at a higher altitude or not? What if we throw a bit more plutonium into the mix? And so on. It just keeps going from there. You add more variables and you answer more questions. It's the sheer number of variables that makes the massive parallelism such a boon here. One processor can work on the effects of humidity, while another can work on the fluid dynamics of the fissile uranium. In the oil and gas industry, geoscientists process enormous amounts of seismic data, images and simulations to better understand where they should dig to extract minerals, oil or gas. They need to ensure that when interfering with water tables underneath the surface, they don't damage the environment, rivers and creeks hundreds of kilometers away. HPC can also be used in these industries to improve employee safety. I've seen people design using HPC and engineers working at petroleum companies using HPC to design better oil platforms that are stronger, more sustainable, and pipelines that are less tolerant to damage and explosion. With everything I've just shown you, I hope you can see how high-performance computing enables innovation, both in the academic sector and industry. It is truly a technology which can increase not only the competitiveness of your science, but the competitiveness of the Australian economy and the improved lifestyle which we are lucky to live. Those what-if questions which your colleagues say are impossible to answer have gone head-to-head with HPC for decades, and HPC has won. 50 years ago, most of the population would laugh at the thought of landing on the moon. But thanks to engineers utilizing HPC, we created a way. Utilizing HPC in this way is just one of many giant leaps for mankind. Finally, I'd like to leave everybody thinking, how can I now take the information that I know about high-performance computing and apply that to my research? How can I solve the problems which plague my research on a daily basis, and how can I accelerate my science? if you're truly interested in improving your research output and improving the outcomes that you seek to gain, please feel free to contact us at vpac.org or follow us on Twitter or Facebook and LinkedIn. I wish everybody good luck completing their PhDs and all their research, and look forward to working with you in the future. Thank you.